Well, it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Coyne. If you feel inadequate with Dr. Beckham, I feel inadequate being associated with Dr. Coyne. Seven or eight years ago, I had an invitation to come to a presentation by another department on campus, and sometimes, you know, you're busy, and so sometimes you don't think to do so. But I decided to attend this lecture, and it was by Dr. Coyne. She was at the time was teaching at a university in England, and I was so impressed with this presentation. She was presenting on the media and children's relational aggression and so forth. And so I went down and talked with Dr. Coyne. I said, if you're not a good fit to this department, we really will be interested in having you come and visit with our faculty and possibly applying. And that's probably one of the better decisions I've ever made, is to be able to show up to that lecture. You've heard the phrase that if it's too good to be true, it's probably not true, but this is not the case with Dr. Coyne. She's not only too good to be true, she is true. She's an outstanding researcher. She's the type of person that the BYU administration just absolutely loves. She has many, many strengths in many areas. She's an outstanding researcher, one of the most prolific researchers in our department. She has an ability to conceptualize issues and conceptualize problems and present them in very, very unique ways and very informative ways, and she's very prolific in doing it. She's also a very good teacher, outstanding teacher. Her students just absolutely love her. And if there's a problem in the faculty, if some faculty, young faculty, struggling with their teaching technique, the administration says, go visit Dr. Coyne's class, see what she's doing, copy her. She's also an outstanding mentor with students, with graduate and undergraduate. She is always surrounded by many, many, many students, so the university loves this mentoring that she does. She's also a good colleague, and she's willing to do and accept responsibilities without complaining. And we all admire. We always wonder, where does she get this energy, and to do all of these type of things? And she does them without complaining. So she's an outstanding colleague. She's an outstanding mother. Her mother is here, and her husband is here. And I think the last time I checked, she's an outstanding wife. Is that true? But yeah. And so she's really outstanding in these characteristics, and so we're just thrilled to have Sarah as a colleague and as associate, and I'm going to turn the time over to Sarah.
Thanks, Clyde. That's a lot to live up to. I appreciate that introduction. I'm so grateful to be here to talk about our Disney Princess study, and I'm so grateful to the Beckham family for funding this lecture series and for all they do for the university. Okay, so the idea for this project started 3 years ago, and I was at a gender development conference in San Francisco, and the keynote speaker was a woman called Peggy Orenstein, and she had just written a book called Cinderella Ate My Daughter. And she's not a researcher, not a professor, she's a journalist. And it was making the point that Disney princesses might not be all that cracked up to what we think they are. And maybe they're really bad for little girls. Maybe they're sexualizing our society too soon, and maybe they focus on appearance too much, and it all starts at age 3 and 4. And so I'm sitting in the audience, and at the time I have a daughter who is 3 years old, Hannah, and her words are kind of just washing over me, because Hannah loves princesses. I mean, she loves them. Everything about princesses. And I'm like, am I a bad mother? What am I doing to my child? I feel like I'm media savvy. I researched it for decades here. What's going on? So this is Hannah, age 3, she was Snow White. Age 4, it's a blurry picture because it's from my cell phone, but she's Merida from Brave. So she just loves princesses. And so as I sat there, Peggy Orenstein said, there's no research at all to back me up on what I'm saying. And I thought, well, that's interesting. I do that. That's my job. I do research on kids and media. So I thought, okay, I'll do a study on this. And so that's kind of how the idea for the study was born. All right, so first I want to ask, how are Disney princesses portrayed in the media? So I have a little clip for you, just to give you I don't know how familiar you are with the Disney princess world. So let me just give you a taste here. All right, and hopefully this will all work. So I just want you to pick out the gender stereotypes that you see. How girly girl is your Rapunzel hair? So just in that little clip, we saw tons of different female gender stereotypes, from baking to sewing to ballet to all sorts of things. And lucky for Rapunzel, she decides to have an adventure later on in the show, if you've seen it. Okay, let me get back to this. All right, a little bit of research on this. Me and my students conducted a content analysis where we watched all of the Disney movies and coded the princesses for different things. It was a fun study. And then we also, unfortunately, before it was published, Don England got the same study in, so ours, unfortunately, is not published. But what we find is that Disney princess movies are highly gender stereotyped. No big surprises there. What we found is that princesses are more gender stereotyped than other Disney females. So if you just look at all the females in the Disney movies, the princesses are the most gender stereotyped of them all. They also talk more about appearance than other Disney females, which I thought was really interesting from a body image perspective, which we'll get into in a bit. And we also coded for something that I called anti-appearance related themes. So Belle, do you guys know Belle from Beauty and the Beast? Okay, great example of this. So she talks all the time about how appearance doesn't matter, right? So it's what's within that counts. And so I thought, well, maybe the princesses really focus on that. And what we found is that we don't see a lot of it. Belle is great, but what we find is that the other characters do a lot more of that than the princesses themselves. The other thing we found is that they are getting way better over time. They're getting less gender stereotyped over time. So when you actually look at the princesses themselves and who are the most gender stereotyped, so here are the worst offenders, Aurora, Snow White, and Cinderella. So all of the older princesses, all very meek, Sleeping Beauty really doesn't do much but fall asleep in the film. So, not a lot of depth there. Who are the least gender stereotyped? We got Pocahontas, Tiana, who's actually a frog for most of the movie, and then Mulan, who actually plays a boy for most of the movie. So, we do have a lot of depth in Disney, which I appreciated. And now, Merida. So, Merida's not in our study, she's too new. She came out right in the middle of when I was doing the Princess study. And how many of you guys have seen the movie Brave? Okay, so quite a few of you. Let me, here's Merida. Let me just show you a little clip from Merida. Because I feel like Disney, they're kind of catching the vision here. They're trying to figure it out. Okay.
Merida, I forbid it.
Okay, so if you've not seen the movie, I highly, highly recommend it. When it came out in theaters, I was thrilled. Okay, so I'm princess obsessed with doing this study. It's all I think about these days. And here was a princess I could really get behind, right? So someone who was really strong and independent and who brave, right? That's the title of the film. And look at her. Okay, so she's not stick thin. Her hair is crazy. Her face isn't prettified. I could really get behind Merida, and I took my daughter to see it, and we just loved that film. It was so fun. And then, here's what Disney did to her. So in their merchandising and marketing campaign, this is the new Merida. This is how they made her look. So this is the Merida that you'll see on all of the Disney princess paraphernalia and all over the stores. So you'll see it's a very different Merida. They prettified her, as I call it. They've slimmed her up. She's got the shoulders bared, the hip cocked, the arrow, bow and arrow is gone now. So I was really disappointed with Disney for producing a good Merida and then to sell their product to make her like this. And so this is the new line of Disney princesses. And if you'll look closely, I don't know how much you can see it, but they've changed quite a few of them. Princess Aurora doesn't really look like herself, and neither does Belle, right? She looks kind of different. And then look at Mulan over there on the fringes. Not the Mulan that I showed you earlier. It barely looks like her at all. So Disney is very much contributing to this whole girly girl, pretty, pretty princess culture that we see. So what are the effects? That is the big old question here. All right, so to introduce this, I have one more video clip for you. And it's actually from kind of an older TV show. Let me see if I can find it here. When I was in college, I used to like Ally McBeal. I don't know if anyone's watched it, but this is a little clip talking about
Seriously, Renee, what?
Disney
this
princesses.
Thing about being married. Why do you think women were brainwashed?
First stories we hear is babies. Snow White, Cinderella. All about getting a guy, being saved by the guy. Today it's Little Mermaid, Aladdin, Pocahontas. All about getting a guy.
So basically we're screwed up because of
Disney.
Okay. Oh, where is it? There we go. All right, so are we screwed up because of Disney? That's the question. What are the effects of watching these princesses over and over and over again? And they've been around since the 1930s, right? It's not a new thing. So what are the effects? All right, so I searched far and wide, and there isn't a lot of research out there on Disney princesses. So here's what I did find. So the first study, avid princess fans show more gender stereotyping in play. Now this is 5 kindergarten girls, so it's not a big sample at all, but showing a little bit more gender stereotyping. This next study found that exposure to beauty themes in Disney princess media was not related to body image. The fear is, right, that we see all these thin, beautiful models in the princess movies. Does that contribute to poor body image? But they found it didn't. We've done a couple of different content analyses. We find that the Disney films are highly pro-social. So there's so much good that goes on in these films. About 2x every single minute. That's a lot. So highly, highly pro-social. And then another content analysis we've done, we looked at relational aggression, so like the mean girl behavior. We find that 100% of Disney movies have relational aggression, but it's usually by the villain. So the worst movie of all is Cinderella, but it's the wicked stepmother, right? And the stepsisters who are the most relationally aggressive. And we don't see a lot of it from the princesses. So that kind of sets up the scene here. And I should mention, so even though Disney princesses have been around a very long time, we're living in a new world with princesses. So when you were kids, you probably did not go out and buy princess merchandise. It just didn't exist. It wasn't until about 2002 that the Disney princess line was born. And now it's a billion-dollar industry. And if you go into the Disney store, right, that's like an eye-opener. So much, but anywhere, Shopko, Walmart, everywhere. These Disney princess merchandise is just everywhere. All right, so the research questions for our study. So we were interested, what are the effects of exposure to Disney princess-related media on gender stereotyping, body image, pro-social behavior, and aggression in early childhood? Are Disney princesses bad or good for little girls? We really wanted to find out. We predicted that higher levels of Disney princess exposure would be related to more female gender stereotyping, because they're gender stereotyped in the films, worse body image, higher levels of pro-social behavior, because we see so much of it, and lower aggression. We also wanted to find out if the effect was just cross-sectional or if it was over time. And this was just kind of just my own little benefit here, but how do parents and their kids feel about Disney princesses? What do they mean to them? Who do they like? All right, so I want to give a little shout out to all of my research assistants. This project's been going over for 3 years. So I worked with a lot of students on the projects, and it would not be possible without the many students here. So let me describe the study. It consists of 307 participants, about half female. Half of them came from the BYU preschool on campus. 18% came from Linfield College, which is in Oregon. It's a partner school up there. And then 27% are from the Head Start school district in Orem. So we were trying to get a little bit of diversity. I mean, BYU preschoolers are not the most diverse bunch. So that's kind of why we sought participants otherwise. 73% response rate. Children's age is about 4 to 5 years old. And the parents themselves, 80% were white, 20% other. And you can see some statistics for a college degree, if they had it, not, and then their annual income. So kind of on the, a little bit more highly educated, more upper income level, but we do have some diversity, which is great. All right, so we gave parents, kids, and their teachers a bunch of different measures. So the first were the media items, and those are the most important, most relevant to the study. So three questions for Disney princesses. So the first was, how much do you identify with your favorite princess?